Okay, the Brattleboro Planning Commission meeting of Monday, November 3rd, 2014 will come to order. We do not have a quorum, so we will not approve the minutes. Are there any announcements? Non-quorum announcements?
No, other, no. Well, I mean, oh, well, because we're going to the Vermont Planners Association meeting
on Friday,
where we will pick up our award for Plan of the Year.
Plan of the Year. Woohoo! There's no public, so there's no public comment. So we will begin our work session, and we'll turn our work over to our consultant, Brandy Saxton.
Okay. And we are going to pick up where we left off at the overlay zoning districts.
Is that all in the packet you sent? Because I didn't bring anything else but that packet in my mouth.
Yes.
Okay. So the first overlay district is the flood hazard overlay district. And pretty much this is mandated by state and federal regulations. So I wasn't going to go through it line by line. If there were questions or comments, I think we can address those, but this is not an area where you have lots of discretion.
Can you tell me what page that's on?
It begins on page
2-443.
Yeah, somebody else is going to have to, because I'm now looking at my new draft that has different page numbers.
2-443. Do you need a copy?
I don't know yet. No, here it is. Okay.
Yeah, it should be there.
Thanks.
There we go. All right. Well, if this is what it is, I don't have any comments.
I guess Carolina? I don't either, I guess, right?
Carolina?
Well, we can't change it, right?
Well, there's some, you know,
there places where we can.
There's a little bit of wiggly room.
Could you identify where those are so then we can adjust that?
So we can wiggle appropriately.
Yes. Shall I sing?
Well.
In a Pilates cup, you know?
So I think what you probably have the most control over is sort of some ways the level of review that you would want to give things. A lot of the items in here, if you're looking at page, the figure 219, the table, you know, what's conditional?
2-16.
2-16.
Yeah, page 44.
I'm sorry. Yes.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I have my new printout, which has different page numbers and different numbers because I've been editing things as we go along. So, sorry. You know, in terms of what's permitted and what's conditional, you could change some of those things in terms of the level of review in either direction if you wanted to. I don't think that that's necessarily mandated. I mean, all of these things require permitting, but the level of review is something you could address.
And I think it's consistent with what we have now.
I'm reading fast. Sorry. Can you just describe what's the difference between outside the flood? Within the floodway, is the flood hazard area according to the FEMA maps? Or?
No.
Okay.
The flood hazard area consists of both zones, the floodway and then the area beyond the floodway. The floodway is where there is going to be moving water during the flood, definitely. So that is designated, and you can't. You can't build within the floodway.
Flood hazard area
really
goes one more out.
Yeah.
So it's the floodway and the flood fringe, I think it's called.
Yeah, but it's all the floodplain. It's just that there's two zones sort of in that.
Well,
area.
I remember this. You guys weren't here when we were doing the whetstone. Oh, God.
Yeah. So the regulations are very particular about anything that would be built within the floodway that would raise the elevation of the floodwaters.
Right. So it's the bathtub thing. If you displace the water, then it goes further up the side of the bathtub. So they basically don't want unregulated displacement of floodwaters. You'd have to make what they call some compensatory
Right.
storage so that the overall flood waters do not rise higher than the predetermined.
Than the displacement that your building would create.
Yeah, so there are examples around of structures that have been built that encroach on the flood.
The Cumberland Farms would be one where they did that basin, or would they just do that as sort of a extra?
They weren't in the floodway. They were in the flood fringe. But it was a displacement. It wasn't a regulatory displacement, but they built the sort of detention basin as a flood attenuation tool. Yeah.
And so for the things that are permitted in here, is that is there like a site design review? I mean, there's some of these things where I think, you know, it's like, why would you permit water and wastewater systems?
There's a whole set of design kind of guidance that FEMA puts out.
Mm-hmm.
And so you want to, you know, in that situation, you want to make sure that in a flood situation, it's not backing, you know, that a wastewater system isn't going to get overwhelmed and it's going to come out. So you're doing review, and, you know, the engineers, effluent.
Thank you.
The engineers are going to design it, or, you know, to a certain.
Never at a loss for words.
So it's permitted, but the design, but there's other design standards in place that are going to define
it's
how
it's ironic, okay. But yeah, almost every wastewater treatment plant that you can think of in this region of the country is in the floodplain.
Because you're discharging to the waterways. Mm-hmm. Right.
So if you move on to the next point, the development standards. So there is one for utilities. So.
Yes. Yep. And these development standards are almost verbatim out of federal regulation.
Okay. And then there's further guidance about how you can actually do that too.
Which is meant to impart to you the idea that it's not just that we're constrained by state regulatory settings, the state itself is constrained by federal regulatory settings.
Right.
So there's not much scope for changing things easily here.
Can you make it more stringent than what the state requires?
Yeah.
Yes, you can, but then the onus on you demonstrating that it's sound from an engineering standpoint and it doesn't present any kind of legal jeopardy is that the onus is borne more by the locality, and so the expense of that is not inconsequential.
Okay.
And
awesome.
This is
sounds good
protecting the health and safety of the community.
Mm-hmm. And by meeting the regs, we are allowed to participate in the National
Flood Insurance Program, which then gives us a discount. Well, it means that we are eligible for National Flood Insurance Program-backed insurance.
Mm-hmm. It's probably also a good thing to note that this section contains its own set of definitions, because some of the definitions that apply in the flood regulations are actually different than the definitions of the same words that apply elsewhere in the regulations. For confusion's sake.
Right, because why would you do that? Why would you miss that opportunity?
Yes, because under the federal regulations, they have certain definitions, like the definition of development is different, a very key definition. And so I've tried to note where those are different, so that's a little bit more obvious to people that there is a difference.
Okay.
So then we come to the Historic Resource Overlay District.
It's on page 53.
And this is something that has come out of your master plan. We talked about it a little bit at the technical review stage. So I've thrown together some initial language to get reactions to and see what you think about the concept of it. So the overlay district would cover the National Register historic districts, of which, did you say there are four?
Well, there's a whole, there's
four, five.
Four, let's see, there's downtown, West Brattleboro Green, Clark Canal, and the Homestead Horton Neighborhood Historic Districts. But there's also a couple that have multiple buildings on them, so the SD Oregon Complex, the Retreat, and the Dickinson Estate, which I'm not really, guess they're not.
Where is the Dickinson Estate?
It's the corner of Dickinson and Kipling Road. It was listed as Brattleboro.
Are they, is it listed as a site or as an individual
The Dickinson one is called Dickinson Estate Historic District.
District. Well,
and then it's the SD Oregon Complex. There's 19
buildings.
And actually, when I think about that one, I think that these actually are really appropriate. I mean, under the ownership now, I think that it's in good hands. And the PUD actually might have some strong language, so maybe it's not even necessary. I think the PUD does have some design standards. And then the other one was the retreat, Bradbury Retreat, which is 38 buildings.
Mm-hmm. Are there any historic, like historic registered buildings that don't fall into one of those districts?
Yes.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, there's individual listings.
So do they then are not covered by
this? They would not be covered by this as it's written now. It's just meant to encompass the districts and not the individual structures.
And if new districts are incorporated or established, they would be privy.
Yeah. If we're going to do it this way, we'll reference the maps we'll do it by reference. And so if the maps change and there's new districts, that would get sucked into this.
Great.
And I would say that what's written here now is probably a little more appropriate for the downtown. Mm-hmm. And if we want to continue in this vein, I will need to do some additional writing for the other districts.
That include the others, huh?
Yes. And there's also, I have recently discovered, a much improved set of guidance online from the Secretary of Interior Standards. Now there's actual design guidelines, essentially.
For historic districts?
Yes.
Or home?
That go through preferred treatments for various, it goes through...
I'm very familiar with the one on windows.
Yes. So those are much more specific than the guidance that used to be available in terms of what's recommended and not recommended. So though that language could be used as a point of reference for these, they're specific enough to really serve as design guidelines, if you want to look at them and see if those are of interest.
Do you recommend that? Is that necessary, you think?
It would certainly... I have some concerns, and I think one of the things we have to talk about is if the DRB is going to be using those, their level of comfort and familiarity with architectural terms and
the more specific we can be, the better off the whole process.
That might be a lot to throw at them. It's a very high level of detail that's available in those documents. So that may be good in one way, but it may also be making the design review seem like it's a much more complicated thing than maybe you want it to be. So
I would assume that it's meant for towns that have historic commissions as well, so that they can handle that aspect for the DRB, sign off on it for them, and they don't have to worry their pretty little heads about it.
Right.
I think the question of who is going to, who would do this review is an important one. A lot of towns do have a different board or committee that reviews it.
Historical things,
Or design professionals.
A design professionals advisory committee or something like that.
I think if we could pull one of those together, it would be beneficial, but I don't know if we could staff it.
I think we'd be better off having a full contingent of planning commission members.
Doesn't seem to be enough people to go around, isn't it?
Some cloning would be good. All right.
So the design guidelines for downtown Brattleboro is an entirely separate document.
It is.
And so the idea is that that would be used as it says should be consulted for further guidance.
Yes,
good.
It would, but that's more appropriate for the downtown
only. Mm-hmm. So then, where are they going for the? I mean, if this new document is too complicated for the DRB, then where are they going for guidance for the other areas?
Well, there is some guidance from obviously from the West Brattleboro master plan document as well. I can't remember now what that's called.
West Brattleboro.
Okay. So there's some guidance there that can be pulled, and I could certainly. Not unlike what's here, where we've got building facades, windows, that kind of language could be distilled out of those preservation I can't remember what they're calling them. I think preservation briefs or something like that. That, you know,
more appropriate to residential buildings.
That would be more appropriate to residential buildings. That would be helpful for the other parts of the historic districts.
Okay. And then do we need to concern ourselves with these other historic buildings that are not found in the district?
I'm reluctant to say yes. The one provisional thing there gets back to a kind of a boundary change, which would be changing the urban center or the downtown designation to incorporate Park Place, which is just to the north of the courthouse.
And that's that area that James had always talked about.
I don't think any of those are listed individually.
No, I don't think they are either. And so
they'd be good ones to be listed, though, for sure.
They're
better off listing as a district.
As a neighborhood, you know, starting on if you were to walk from the Putney Road side across Park Place, you know, sort of starting near the courthouse and going around that little loop, those larger grand Victorian homes have been repurposed as offices, with some apartments upstairs with most of them. And is it zoned office now? It's zoned something funny.
I think it's residential
office. And so the idea there would be to broaden the range of uses by incorporating them into the urban center, but having something that would language in perhaps this section through the use of a historic resource overlay to protect the physical appearance of the outside of the buildings and the landscaping to some extent.
We decided not to include that in the urban center.
Yeah, we put them in so mixed use, I think.
Yeah, right. It's in the mixed use.
I guess, yeah.
Is that on the building forms? But
right.
But where they are in the other aspect of the zoning, I mean, I was going to say it doesn't matter. Obviously, it does matter. But this historic overlay, regardless of how they're categorized in other zoning, the historic overlay would apply. So can this overlay cover those other spots that are not? Or is the Park Place the only one?
Would have to be identified as a historic district and
that
whole process. And usually a consultant does that.
From the state. Mm-hmm.
Oh, okay. So you can't just be like that one.
It has to be photographed and documented,
yeah,
and then
history. And stuff
the property owner needs to be notified that you're doing this to their building.
I'm the water girl. This history stuff. What?
So I would have to go through and look at the list, but my guess is if there are individual structures that are individually listed that are not in a district, that they are some sort of fairly substantial structure, like a church or something like that, that probably an individual house on its own is unlikely, unless there's something very remarkable about it, to be listed
in
an individual structure on the National Register.
Yeah, we do have a couple, but most of them fall within the district. There might be like four other individual structures.
It's like the one in West Brattleboro where the Tasha Tudor Museum is. That one, the red house?
Yeah,
possibly.
I think so. Well, that might be in the district.
Is that in the district? Might be.
I think it's in the district.
It's on
HGTV. It's in the village, no? Yeah. I think I'm pretty sure it's in the village.
Yeah. There's a couple. There's one on Western Ave. There's one on Putney Road, an individual house.
The one with the big
tree. The one with the big tree.
One that's for sale. No. It's right across from the common. It's one of the ones that's for sale. The property owner listed it.
It's a big green one?
The brownish one. There's two for sale right next to each other.
Oh, right at the end of Putney Road, the brown. Mm-hmm. Yeah, so that one of them is.
Yep.
Right. Okay.
So
I think we should keep, for now, I mean, I think we should assume that the DRB would be doing the review, and so I think maybe using the preservation briefs as a reference would be okay, but I don't know that it should be the standard. I don't know. I'm worried.
We need something a little more
to think
specific
about this
for them. I think possibly.
I think so. I think there should be another set of standards like you have here for mm-hmm. residential.
You're saying for residential?
Yeah, at 252D.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. What's wrong with these?
D or B?
D.
What's wrong with these as written for residential?
Well, they're for the downtown, so I'm assuming. Well,
yeah, I mean, that would need to be.
That's all. That's the only difference.
So, I can tweak the wording, but that the content could probably be fairly
similar.
And I think perhaps for at least an initial go at this, keeping it to sort of the portions of the building that have public vantage
points. The town I used to live in, it was if it can be seen from the street.
Right.
Yeah, and you had that language.
I think I have that language in there, and I would sort of recommend sticking with that at least in this initial run through. If this is something that builds over time and you do end up with a more formal design review process, you could maybe start looking a little more holistically at the buildings at that point. But I think
otherwise, it's kind of intrusive.
And I just want to point out that this also only applies to contributing historic structures, so not everything in the district is
contributing. Right.
Like your non-contributing shed.
Right.
Garage. Like in the downtown, like this is a contributing structure, but the Key Bank building is not.
Mm-hmm.
Right. I had a question on the utilities and mechanical equipment. It was written that utilities must be located underground. And I just didn't know how that would be, because we typically don't have underground.
That's an expense.
Yes.
I understand why.
It does have to the greatest extent, feasible component for it. So maybe it's more, you know, in these districts, it's more of what's probably already there.
Mm-hmm.
So there's nothing underground.
Yeah.
On a good day, except, you know, the sewer lines out. But
Archer could potentially get underground.
So it may be something to sort of think about, anything new that would be added to the structure that you would want to try to get it
Out
of sight.
I would ditch utilities must be located underground, but I would probably make a specific reference to the attachment of satellite dishes.
Mm-hmm. Even though it says to the greatest extent feasible, because it's not, it's actually not saying they must be located underground. It's saying if it's possible to locate them underground, you must do that. But if it's not possible, then
to the greatest extent feasible.
It's okay. Maybe the way it is, but then I would
probably. You want something specific for
about satellite dishes.
What do you want to say about satellite dishes?
No satellite dishes.
They should
visible.
Not go on the front.
The satellite dishes shouldn't be visible from the street.
Can you do that?
We'll have to put the same sort of caveat language on it that says
if
that
that's your only reception.
If you have to be able to allow them to get reception.
Yeah.
So if they're angled such a way that.
I remember reviewing this for Rockingham.
I know.
Yes.
But no one in the historic districts here are not able to get cable.
It doesn't matter if you can get cable.
Yeah.
You are allowed to have a satellite dish.
Yeah, I think it's the FCC.
Why can't
again.
You have cable?
You can have cable, but it's your God given right to also have.
A satellite dish.
Direct TV.
You cannot limit them to cable.
To just
if cable is accessible.
You may
they
need
must
the full NFL package.
The full opportunity to pursue media interaction.
Should we just put that in there? Knock yourself out. Get the NFL package.
Yes. I think so.
Satellite.
Let's
dish.
Just not touch the satellite dishes because
okay.
it's
right.
another.
I've been persuaded.
Well, it's a utility, isn't it?
I think
no.
It doesn't fall under utility.
No, it doesn't. That's one of the weird issues.
We do. There is an exemption.
Is it mechanical
remember?
Equipment? What is it? What do you call
it's communications it? Communications equipment.
Telecommunications equipment.
Covered by the FCC.
Yes.
Well, what about then? What about like cell towers? Or are there other telecommunications equipment? Or
well,
radio equipment.
Your
yes.
cell phone tower
one.
Is okay.
Yeah, we can't stop. We can't stop somebody from also putting up a ham radio antenna on their historic building. No.
But can you produce language that asks for it to be screened if at all possible?
Underground. I think that's where you want to go with that.
So on a serious note here, in the exemptions portion of the regulations that we looked at previously, we do have an outright exemption from needing to get a zoning permit for antennas and satellite dishes, residential size ones, essentially. We do have language that says that those devices should be installed on the least visible location. And we could certainly...
That sounds perfect.
Yeah, we could certainly just sort of emphasize that again here with a sentence that, you know, this needs to be located to the, you know, side or rear preferably.
Right.
Not visible from the street, unless a locate that, you know...
Demonstrate that that's not feasible.
And have a lacy dish compatible with the Victorian fenestration or something.
Mm-hmm. I can take a picture of my neighbor's lovely historic house with the satellite dish nicely hidden behind the chimney. It's a perfect view right out my window. We'll put it right here.
Okay. Great. Good. Listen.
So, we can do that.
Well, that's great.
So generally, we like the concept of the Historic Resource Overlay District. I will tweak and beef up the language, and we'll do a map so that when we discuss this, we have a better... I haven't really mapped this out yet, so I need to look at the map and sort of get a good sense of...
Yeah, so we definitely want the Downtown District and the West Brattleboro Village Green Historic District. The Clark Canal, I should pull those maps and find out. I mean, there it's a lot of residential in the Clark Canal and the Homestead Horton Place canal, in which we were talking about before the meeting. We can still do design review on 1 and 2 family homes. So if there's contributing structures, residential structures in there, then they could have the design review as well.
Is the Berkeley Vela Real Estate Office a historic building?
No, I don't believe so.
Mm-hmm.
No. How do you get more historic buildings? I feel like there's so many buildings in town that could or should be listed, but it's probably a pretty onerous process.
Individual listing, I think, is actually more difficult because you have to prove that there's some sort of historic
merit in and of itself rather than the district forming an
important person or an event or an architect.
Design. Some sort of those houses that have a name on them. There's some on Western Avenue there by Holton Home that have some kind of name plaques on
some of them.
Yep.
Cool.
So there is, so I would just say that.
Like, I think the area around Tyler Street would make a nice district.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a pretty amazing area too.
I think most of the historic district designations that we've had or expansions of them have actually come through Windsor. I'm just not going to say it's a housing trust because if they're in a district they can get I think some tax credits
for the tax credits
so they hire a preservation consultant and they make the case because there's a lot of as Liz said there's a lot of documentation
sometimes towns have volunteers and they do all that legwork but that takes a lot of educated manpower
you see that a lot where in Massachusetts because they have a mechanism for supporting local efforts in conservation and affordable housing and historic preservation through a kind of a matched local tax assessment that they do.
It'd be interesting if there was like a clinic. You know, some of the law schools would do law clinics where they provide pro bono work for environmental things. So it'd be cool if there's like an historic architecture clinic.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that'd be good.
Yeah, why not? Architecture student was not doing anything next year.
That you know.
I thought she was going to do fenestration big time.
Yeah.
So that actually concludes the overlay districts, unless you have some further discussion. Check. Woohoo. And brings us around to part 3.
I have part 4. Do I have part 3?
It was emailed to you.
Sorry.
You haven't read it.
This is the dense, fun-filled technical section. beginning with the site design and engineering standards.
Mm-hmm.
So the basic principle that you will see in this chapter is that there are very sort of specific and quantitative standards for the most part. Usually a little or a lot more specific and quantitative than what's in the current zoning. In a few places I dialed a couple of things back, but for the most part it's actually a dialing up of that. And the idea being that if the standards are more clear and precise, that it will result in more sort of predictable and understandable outcomes, so that the DRB are not having as much gray area to interpret, and these, particularly on some of the more engineering-oriented things, there just are some standards, there are precise standards that have to be met. So that's the underlying philosophy behind this section.
It's really broken down into very detailed stuff.
It is very detailed.
I mean, there's 11 items alone under
access and circulation.
Yeah, plus sub-items under some of them, like, how long is my throat?
Yes. Right.
So can you, the whole zoning thing, it's relatively new to me, and I've never worked on a development or something, how does this work in conjunction with the zoning district? So this is kind of like general standards, and then and then you would also take the information from the zoning district and apply that to the specific, you know, building or whatever in terms of the setback from the street. And
yeah, so the zoning district controls those aspects, things like the setbacks, what uses are allowed, the dimensional standards of buildings and things like that. So all the things here in part three, they all deal with other aspects that aren't covered in the individual districts, and for the most part, they're not going to vary that much. In some cases, they do have things that are broken out by district, but it basically applies to all development of a certain type or class. So most of these sections begin with some sort of applicability statement. So say this first one, access and circulation, says that this one applies to all development. So all development has to have access and circulation that meets the requirements of this section. When we get to some others, you will see that it applies maybe only to commercial and industrial and multifamily residential things. So some of these standards don't apply to all uses, and it varies depending on the standard.
Yeah.
So that applicability piece is important to look at in terms of what this does apply to.
So is there the potential for contradicting ourselves between this and or not?
Our
really.
Goal is to try to not do that.
But there, okay. So that would be something to watch for.
It is something to think about, how the pieces fit together. And that is certainly something now that once we get a full draft and we have all the elements, that it will take some cross-checking back and forth. You know, something to look at. We have a section in here on buffers and landscaping. Make sure that fits. I have been trying to do that. Go back and make sure that ends up fitting with where we ended up with on setbacks and things like that in the districts, so that we aren't, you know, creating sort of internal contradictions. And we'll be doing a little bit of that as we go along.
I feel like this is the perfect place for an app where, you know, you would have like would have the zoning district and then you would have all applicable things, and so you could pick a property and it would spit out like, okay, this and this and this and this.
But it also depends on what you're doing.
There is that app. It's called the Zoning Administrator.
Yeah, right.
Extension 1111.
And the one I have not done this yet, but one idea is to either at the beginning or the end of this part three to have a table that would just sort of run through all these sections and say what they apply to.
Yeah.
So that there would be a little brief summary.
Kind of a checklist.
Yeah.
Right.
So these replace the existing ones that the DRB has told us were outdated and cumbersome.
Non-specific.
Yes, and vague.
Non-specific.
Yes.
So the specificity is good, because it's what they've asked for and it's what we want to provide.
Right. Mm-hmm. We're responding to their input.
Their need. Yeah.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Well, not just them, but state
what's
laws,
appropriate,
state, you know,
right.
how things have been interpreted in court cases. And
right.
Mm-hmm. and to, you know, establish some a baseline of acceptable level of design and engineering that you want to see.
And what I, the way I look at them is they're really, they are detailed, they give us the specificity that we want. It's staff's job to review applications and to kind of help the DRB.
Right. So, you know, has Brian read these? Has staff read these and find some things that they'll be helpful?
We've memorized them.
Start reciting then.
Oh.
But like Brian.
Yep.
Yeah, he's reviewing.
Welcoming this.
Has there been feedback from him on specific?
Yeah.
No, we've had
you've adjusted
we've had a first
internally
review. We've given Brandy.
Yeah, this is the I did a first draft. They reviewed. We did a second draft. You know, there's still maybe a few bumps here and there to smooth out, and we'll probably get feedback similarly from you guys and from the public as we go through to further refine. But you know, in terms of overall content, I think we've covered all the bases with this. We shouldn't have to do whole cloth revision, I wouldn't think, at this point. We're moving things around a little bit or tweaking around the edges, but trying to address also, you know, like we haven't gotten to parking and loading, but you know, when the technical review, we spoke quite a bit about trying to do what we can to bring the parking to more modern standards, reducing impervious surface and stuff like that. So there's a lot of new language in parking and loading that aims towards that.
That's one of the things I was just thinking about, like the walkway, just talking about the public sidewalks and walkways. There's no mention of the use of impervious surface. Is that prohibitively expensive or something, or unreasonable thing to request?
So I think it's unreasonable because of the frost.
That's a myth.
So there is a stormwater section that does get to some of that pervious material piece, and there is provisions in there, so someone could construct a sidewalk that would meet these specifications out of a pervious pavement. And in order to meet stormwater standards, that might be one of the things they would decide to do.
Oh, okay.
But
so depending on the site, it's either more or less necessary or appropriate.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah. So the first cut would be, does my proposed project exceed the impervious surface limit, which is a percentage of the total parcel size? And so if does and you want to keep with that,
then you figure out how to
or there might be that may not be exceeded, but you may have kind of a tight site and want to not devote so much area to conveyance of stormwater separate from parking and pedestrian pathways, and so by using pervious pavers, particularly for pedestrian walks or something like that, you can have that be the area that does the infiltration for you, to some extent. And so, in a tight situation, that might work for you as well.
Mm-hmm.
So it's, and in general, I think people are still, getting used to it as an approach. I think the key concern at this point is that it generally calls for more maintenance, and people are not yet really familiar with the maintenance that it requires. In particular, the pervious blacktop requires vacuuming, and you know how much people love that.
Vacuuming.
Right.
Well, salt and sand. I didn't mean to be so flippant, although I have been flippant all day. So I might have offended.
Sorry. We do flip
it all the time.
It's congenital. It's built in.
It's in the nature of planning. So I'm thinking that unless someone has a specific thing that they want to bring up, we should all just not go over this line by line. And if anyone has any specific comments, either now or our brethren who aren't here, can bring them up in the next meeting.
So, I mean, I can walk through and just sort of give you a little summary of the basic principles that are being applied through these standards, if you want.
By all means.
What's okay. GFA?
Gross floor area.
Gross floor area.
In this rep, yes.
In this rep.
In this document.
Yes.
So in section 311, the access and circulation, in terms of vehicular access, this covers trying to limit access and encourage properties to provide cross access and shared access between them. And there's actually a provision to try to retrofit some of the existing lack of good access management that exists in the commercial corridors over time by getting those cross access points going in. And something I will point out, because I am a little bit aware of, they tried a similar effort to this in South Burlington along Dorset Street and Williston Road, and actually found some level of success with that. There was a lot of pushback when they adopted the retrofit language from the business owners, but after a couple of them were required to do this, connecting their properties, and the customers really liked it, suddenly people started voluntarily doing it. Because there was a lot of good people feedback in terms of this making everyone's life a whole lot easier, that you didn't have to go in and out on the highway.
How that works.
Yeah. So suddenly, a lot of those places where there had been concrete blocks or a fence put up between two properties for no apparent reason, even though there was asphalt on both sides, were open. So that is something of kind of interest there. So that's what we're seeing here with the vehicular access component.
We'll see if that community spirit spreads all
the
way south.
You wouldn't have thought it would have in South Burlington either, but I think that there was some gas stations thought that maybe their competitors were getting some sort of competitive advantage by being more easy to get into than they used to be.
Oh, God.
So it spread a bit. Yes.
That's awesome.
Yeah. So there is a little bit of language here related to public transit, mostly just giving the DRB some room there to make conditions related to transit if a proposed development is an appropriate place for a bus stop or shelter. There is some language related to bicycle access. Once again, this is not necessarily mandatory. Remember, in some of the zoning districts, we did require bicycle racks, so that sort of sucks into this. But giving the DRB the authority to make that a condition where they think it's important or appropriate.
In some of the other language, it points out that if there is a public bicycle rack, that could be used for the one within 200 feet.
Mm-hmm.
Does that have to be in here as well, or is that like assumed? Or
you're right. I didn't. That language is elsewhere. I will look at that. That's a good catch. Public. Okay. In terms of pedestrian access. The idea with the public sidewalk requirement is to try to extend and connect any missing pieces of sidewalk or extend a network immediately. So if there's sidewalk sort of within a quarter mile, that's something then the DRB can require, unless the Public Works Department says otherwise, to try to get any of those missing pieces connected and
mm-hmm.
extend out as you can. And then there's some language for larger parking lots and such to make sure there's safe pedestrian access within a site as well to walk through. So that's your access components. 312, the parking and loading elements. If you remember, in the urban center district, there aren't any parking requirements. So these generally will not apply to that zoning district, but will apply to everything else, and it applies to all other types of development have to provide parking except for in the urban center. So there is a parking table in here that sort of comes towards the end of the section that lists the uses and how much parking they need to have.
Yeah, something like that.
And that's a significantly lowered bar than your current zoning. And in fact, you know, for instance, one way to think about this is that, you know, it's allowed to only have one parking space per dwelling unit under this. Now that will work for some types of housing and it won't necessarily work for others. So these minimums are not set to necessarily be the actual amount that you need. So sometimes they're going to be, you know, going to need to have more. And there is sort of a recognition of that, but the idea is to not be requiring more than is needed. So in fact, we're actually, in some cases, maybe requiring a little less than is needed, and recognizing that parking is a function of the market in many ways, and a developer isn't going to build housing that doesn't have the parking spaces necessarily to go with it, type of thing. There's sort of a problem that we don't really need to solve. It's sort of one that solves itself in some ways.
Mm-hmm. Where does the issue of, I call it handicap parking. It's probably called accessible parking.
It is.
But I read that, and that, like, when you have a hospital, I mean, on this chart, on this table here, there's no listing of how many, like commercial buildings, how many you have to have.
So there is language in here about the accessible parking. I normally don't write the numbers and the dimensional standards into the zoning because they can be changed from the outside. The federal and state governments could override you and change those requirements.
So they're here by reference?
They're here by reference. And those places count towards the total number, so whatever you're mandated to have to meet the state or federal requirements, you'll obviously have to have, but this doesn't set that number.
I asked that for a specific reason. I find it very interesting in this town that things like, say, Price Chopper or Walmart have huge numbers of accessible parking, and yet you go to the hospital, and there's almost none. Yet the hospital is a place where many people come who need accessible parking, and there's just never any available. Wow. It's and that just seems so, it's absurd, but it also seems very wrong. It's like, how do they, you know, there's nothing that requires them to have more?
I would have to go look at what the actual numbers are. It could be that there isn't the same level of requirement for a institutional land use as there is for a commercial one.
Commercial is like 1 per 25, I think, spaces.
I bet you it's much the same, and they have an Act 250 permit.
They have a what?
They have an Act 250 permit that probably governs that too.
Yeah, but...
Like the hospital, you mean?
But the federal, I mean...
I'm wondering about that. That's interesting.
That's really interesting.
It's an interesting problem.
I've complained to them numerous times that there's never any handicap parking.
And are you familiar enough with, say, a neighboring hospital like Cheshire Medical or something, and you see a better provision for handicap parking, or is it something?
I've seen a lot of handicap at Dartmouth.
Yeah.
Yeah, Dartmouth has quite a few. It could have more, but because I've been there, I've been to Cheshire Medical too. I'd have to pay closer attention.
Yeah, I'm not familiar with
Park in the emergency drop.
Just leave the doors open.
Well, there is that hole, that ring around the front.
Yeah,
I know, but that's not handicap parking. Mm-hmm. Not really.
So the other thing that this section does in terms of a maximum amount of parking, you can't do more than twice the minimum unless you can do a parking study that demonstrates that you're going to need more than that. So
it says that somewhere?
Yes, that's 312D. So there's actually a sort of a reversal of the normal thing, which says you have to have at least this amount. We're actually saying you can't have more than this amount unless you can demonstrate
you argue for it?
That you need it.
Right.
And maximum, yes.
Yeah, it's just a straight inversion. Usually it's minimum.
Yeah. Okay. And then there is a provision for shared parking. And I will say, Sue, I know you guys had comments about the percentages.
I was just looking.
And I actually pulled several examples and looked at them. And while there was, I did bring down a couple of them.
Put down evening retail.
Evening retail a little bit. The ranges are kind of fall in this. And there's been several, like, I think Urban Land Institute did one. And there's been several sort of large parking studies done that then have these recommended percentages in them, so I did tweak them a little bit.
Where do these come from? I mean, this is so great to me. I mean, it's like,
well, there's been a number of, you know, like I said, parking plan studies.
It's my ignorance about planning here. Maybe this is standard stuff, but it just seems so
I mean, if you just sort of think of, you can kind of think about it a little bit in terms of when are these, it should make sense when you actually start to look at the numbers and think, well, yes, you know, office people, you're going to need a hall of your spaces during the day when the office is in operation, but, you know, your dining is not going to do so much during the day, but you're going to need more parking in the evening and on the weekends for a restaurant. You know, when you start to think about when places are used, you know, overnight, you're going to have...
Well, this is when they share,
yes.
like with another...
Yeah.
Different
yes.
type
yeah.
of use.
Yeah, so if you had, you know, both an office and residential, you know, they obviously, during the daytime, a lot of the office will be close to their full need of parking, but
and
at night, the residential, most of that, a lot of that will be out, and it'll invert in the evening and nighttime hours. So the idea is that there's a certain amount of overlap that you don't need to provide additional parking for that they can share. So that's the idea behind these tables. So you would calculate the needs at various times and figure out what that amount of parking that you would need totally would be.
And this is an example of where we're being more clear. I mean, I know it seems...
It makes sense, but I mean, when I see all this stuff, I just kind of go blurry, and I was like, okay, I'll wait till the meeting so somebody can explain this. I mean... Because I don't know how to comment about it.
This level of detail will be beneficial for the DFE attempting to make a decision. And I think most applicants are going
to
find this beneficial.
Now that you talk about it, I can understand it. But just looking for me, like a layman, it's that.
Does the town have a noise meter? What does when someone come
Brandy and I had that conversation.
We had the noise meter conversation.
Yeah. The town does not have a noise meter right now. They're not that expensive. And we saw ones online for under 100, so if we needed, that would be fine.
Yeah, it just has to be maintained.
Yeah, Brian had mentioned that in the past when they've done little noise study type things, they've used an app on the phone, which, as Brandy pointed out, is probably okay as long as you're not in court.
If you're going to get called into court, you're going to want your meter that's been calibrated and do the readings that way. But, I mean, the noise numbers, I mean, that's always an issue where you're responding to a complaint. And hopefully, if you can deal with it, that's good.
Is there a section about that?
There is a section about that that comes up.
It's at the end.
It's at the end.
At the end.
I've been reading ahead.
You know, there's also in the parking section, just to return back to that, language, you know, that deals with truck loading areas as well in terms of what's required there. And something that in each of these sections that's also of interest is that many of them have a paragraph that deals with previously developed sites and to what extent we're basically requiring properties to come into compliance. When they do make changes, and it's different in some of the different sections, depending on what it is, to what degree you're trying to retrofit to get things improved. So we then come to sort of an interrelated set of three sections, buffers and screening, landscaping, and fences and walls, and they're sort of interdependent and related. And these are ones that now that we've sort of gotten part two more solidified, I need to go back and cross-reference these tables back against where we ended up with boundaries and what districts are abutting which districts and the setbacks we ended up with. But when I wrote this, these were all in alignment. But things have shifted a little bit, so they may need to be shifted again.
Okay.
So that's something that we'll have to look at one more time. But the buffers set basically just sets up different sets up requirements for buffers between non-compatible land uses between different zoning districts. So, you know, where the commercial district, service district might abut the residential district, you know, what kind of planting, fencing needs to be done there to protect the...
Is that what this table is here?
Yeah, so that's what the table is.
Good options.
Different options for how to meet the requirements. And Does my table help with the equivalent planting units or not?
You know...
What I'm calling my Dr. Seuss trees?
I didn't.
I think your EPUs are pretty... I like it. I like the whole concept of an equivalent planting unit.
An equivalent planting unit. So these
yes.
set up how much vegetation you have to have within the buffer area per 100 feet. And there is some possibility of substituting. So that's what the equivalent planting unit is. So you can determine whether if you have an existing vegetated area, if that meets the standard, then you can just keep that. Yeah. And if you, you know, have a place where you can't really plant the large trees for some space reasons, then you could substitute in some of the smaller plantings to equivalent amount and things like
that. How do you plant
That's
a,
great.
How do you plant a quarter of a tree or a shrub?
You won't. You will round them up.
I like this.
Yes, this does help.
Sort of
Brandon.
Interesting.
I'm not.
It's
like
having
2.2
children.
That's right.
In terms of
so there is a definitions which you do not have, which cover what a large, medium, and small tree or shrub is. And it's actually you do have it because I did write it in. I wrote it in down into Figure 3.11.
Yeah. Yep.
So those are minimum heights for that type
Directed
of
by
Lady Bird Johnson.
Well, I see.
So a large tree is one that, when it's at its maturity, will be over 50 feet. So that's how they're done in this description. So it's not the planting size
oh.
that's the determination here. It's the
this
it's
Final
maturing
height.
This
right.
height.
Okay. This one.
Mature.
Does it have
okay.
like
okay.
a minimum?
Right.
There is a minimum
planting
size.
Size.
Yes,
mm-hmm.
in that table as well.
Yes.
Oh, I see. So it'd be 2 feet, and it would be 6 feet, and 1 foot would be.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah.
So hang on a second. You got material, caliper, height, area. And the mature maintained height. Where is the specific mention of the minimum size? Is it in 309?
That's what the minimum caliper and minimum height are. Maybe that's not
mm-hmm.
clear
yeah.
in the table.
Okay.
But
that's at planting.
Okay. At planting? Yeah.
Yeah.
That really needs to be stated.
Yeah.
Yep.
So that first section deals with buffers and screening. And then we come to the section that deals with landscaping. So there's requirements for if streetscaping along the street. Remember, many of those districts, we required a certain amount of minimum front yard green space, and that will need to be landscaped in accordance with these requirements. Landscaping for around the foundation and area of buildings, and landscaping within parking lots. So there's basically three components to the landscaping.
This doesn't apply to houses, does it?
Not these
no.
components. So if you look at landscaping's applicability statement, which is 314A,
All right.
new development except for single family and two
oh,
family
except,
residential
yes.
uses,
oh,
ag and forestry. So this is one that doesn't apply, unlike parking, which applies to
mm-hmm.
all development. This one, landscaping, only applies to essentially the non residential.
Well, that makes sense.
Yeah.
Is that so? 314D at the end of at least the minimum size requirements specified
yeah.
in zero. That's a
it's a missing cross reference.
Okay.
Good catch. Every time you move something, you have the chance of breaking the cross reference. So,
Brady, one of the things I noticed is this and. Could get cleaned up later on. Some of the first figures in this chapter were not in the right order.
Okay.
As the text, like the text would refer you to like figure 3-4 when it really should be. Like, so 3-1 wasn't headed.
Okay.
Anyway.
I'll have to check because I was moving things around and the numbering was starting to give me a little bit of a problem.
Yeah.
So it's possible
yeah.
that some of the figure
yeah.
numbers
After
might
a while
not be.
It goes berserk on it.
Yeah.
Yes, it does.
And
yes.
a couple places, and this will come later, probably I'm sure in the formatting, is I thought that the figures could be located more to where they're referred to.
They will. I'm not doing that right now in the
yeah.
Word document. I said I was going to make you a pretty one. So
yeah.
like these little landscaping illustrations, they should go alongside the text.
Yeah.
But
okay.
doing that in Word just is
yeah,
a recipe for a disaster. So I'm just keeping it all in a nice
yep.
linear fashion in
yeah.
Word, and I'm putting
okay.
all the tables at the end of each section so that it just minimizes
okay.
the headache factor. But
headache.
I expect to move some of those things around.
I figured.
True.
Yeah, when we make a pretty version. So that's landscaping. And then there is just a little bit of language on fences and walls. And this is something we need to sort out, the 6 versus 8 feet thing, because we also have an exemption. Mm-hmm. And the exemption in part one is for fences up to 6 feet.
Mm-hmm.
And so anything over that does require a zoning permit.
Mm-hmm.
So I know you had made some comments about the different heights, so we need to just make sure.
6 feet seems terribly low.
For a fence?
Yeah. Let me, you know, what's like under your arm. It's like you can see straight over it.
Yeah, a lot of people
arm.
Can.
Mm-hmm.
Right. What's that?
Yeah. Your
yeah.
arm.
Yeah,
what is
like
our exemption now? Is it 8 or 6? I can't even remember what I told you. If it's not over 6, it's exempt.
Yeah. It's 6 and under exempt. So just that seems to me to be low.
Okay.
And fences make good neighbors, which is something that should go on the applicability statement.
The Robert Frost section.
Unless
yes.
they are in the wrong place, in which case they make really bad neighbors.
Yeah.
Really unhappy neighbors.
That's true.
When you find that your neighbor has fenced in
right.
part of your yard.
Yeah. So,
so that's just something we need to make sure. That's like what I caught that we need to make sure that we're internally consistent about the fences and walls question and make sure that we're exempting what you want to exempt in terms of height.
I don't see why we wouldn't keep it at 6 feet. It seems to work.
It would create havoc if we upped it to 8. But it does seem really short.
Not when you're under 6 feet.
Mm-hmm. I think 6 feet is appropriate size for a fence.
Yeah.
You can see things up, like really easily over the top of a 6 foot fence, that's all. Isn't the point of a fence that you don't see things?
No. You can only see over them very well if there's a you're tall enough, or there's enough change in grade.
Yeah.
Okay.
I think you make
might just spend too much time
mountain out of a molehill.
Yeah, I just use buffering for the same thing. It's okay.
Exactly. How high can your dog jump?
Oh, he can do 6 feet.
Can you cut
that's
the
not,
6 foot
yeah,
fence?
That's also not a yeah. Exactly.
I think we should.
A reasonable dog
feet.
Can do 6 feet.
I know.
Well, that's why you live where you do.
Right. Okay.
Okay. So,
yeah, even a dash hound would have a chance at 6 feet.
Oh, come on, Laurie.
Just throw itself out.
Yeah, exactly. Assisted, a properly assisted dash hound.
So, section 316 is outdoor lighting, and this is an entirely sort of new approach to the outdoor lighting section.
Yeah, classes, just like roads.
Yes, so it is very complicated in terms of these three classes
yeah,
and two
really.
Zones. But what it does do is sort out the two zones is good because it gives you both sort of an urban and a rural set of standards
that
which,
makes sense.
Which you kind of need. And then the three different classes of lighting sort of deal with the different types uses of lighting. Whether you need lighting that is lighting up space where you're like outside doing something active,
mm-hmm.
or if it's decorative lighting, or if it's just sort of security lighting type thing. So once
mm-hmm.
people get their heads around the different zones and types, it kind of makes sense. And it, this really actually provides more flexibility than a lot of older lighting ordinances did, where they sort of set just sort of maximums for this, that, and the other thing. This sort of sets a maximum amount of light for the entire property and then provides a fair amount of flexibility about just how that light will be, that amount of light can be distributed around the site and how they choose to light the site.
Why are public street lights exempt? Is it like, do they have to be exempt because they're regulated by state or federal law?
They are in the right of way. So typically zoning does not cover things that occur within the road right of way.
There are requirements that
it's
govern
town property.
Yeah, I mean, and you know,
it's public works.
They're actually installed and operated by Green Mountain Power for the most part, and we pay for it.
Mm-hmm.
And so, you know, the town pays the electricity bill for the streetlights, and the fixtures themselves conform to certain kinds of design requirements that are nationally recognized.
Mm. Is this protective of the night sky?
It is protective of the night sky. So this is these numbers and standards are based on the 2010.
I'm very proud of you. I'm so proud of you.
The 2010 Pattern Outdoor Lighting Code, which is the updated version of what used to be the International Dark Sky Association's Outdoor Lighting Code Handbook from 2000. But you see, lighting technology has come a long way in the last 14 years, and now we have a new and updated version.
You get honorary status in our neighborhood now.
How would this affect, like, again, this is kind of a little bit of, this little chart is a little Greek to me at the moment, but like, these neighborhoods that have petitioned for more streetlights because of safety, yet other citizens want less, or there's been less because of not too much, not too much light pollution. But
I'll tell you how it worked in my neighborhood. I wanted the light out.
Yeah.
And the head of public works said, "Ask your neighbors. I'm going to turn it off for now. You ask your neighbors what they think. And then if we can reach a consensus, I'll do what the consensus is."
That's
and of
nice.
Course, the consensus wanted the lights on, and so they are on.
So it does not deal with the streetlights.
Okay.
So it does not get involved in this argument about whether the streetlights should be on or off.
Right.
Neighborhood by neighborhood. Or
bedroom window by bedroom window, practically. That's generally the
yeah.
Objection.
It yeah, well, when I go pick out a place to live, I drive around on the street at night to see where the lights are before
you,
I rent.
When you did that, did you have to define what the neighbors were? Like, is it people that only are surrounding the light, or did you have to go, like, two or three?
Oh, I went to the ones that were
just
immediately
the
surrounding the light.
Yeah, because we were thinking of doing that, too.
Yeah. I mean, you can ask your neighbors, and it's just funny. I mean,
TV.
It's just really funny, because since I brought it up, the neighbors have put more lights.
Oh, wow.
Oh,
God.
Yes.
Paranoia lights,
I call them. I wonder if it would work if you could ascertain how much you have to pay for that light, and then you just put, like, a fake bill. You hand everyone a fake bill for their yearly part of, like, having to have that light on. Like, how much does it cost?
I think
really?
You'll do a great job in your neighborhood.
Yeah, there'll be shots fired. But I'm not sure the direction that you're hoping for, okay?
Maybe I should be sorry I brought it up.
Yeah, don't call me, okay?
So the outdoor lighting section deals with lighting that will not be
shining
on the streetlight side of things, but it will be on private property.
Commercial.
Yes. And
how about if a light pole, I'm going to be, this is just silly, I'm taking over Kathy's attitude. Like, there's a light that normally was doing its correct thing, shedding light downward, doing the right blah, 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 and then somehow... over the winter, the snowplow hit it, and then it was tilted the wrong way, and it's been that way for the last 2 years, and the light all shines in people's eyes now who are driving down the road instead of shining on the parking lot. Who regulates that?
Who owns this light? Is it in the parking lot, this light?
Yes.
It's on private property?
Yes.
Then that's who's regulating it.
Yep. So
and
then
so if it's...
Better tell Brock.
If it's trespassing, as we like to say, if you have a suffering light trespass issues, then it's the basis for a zoning violation. As long as you can establish the ownership of the light fixture, yeah.
So they set up according to this initially.
Yeah.
And they have to be maintained.
Yeah,
so that's what
I'm asking about,
it
the
does
maintenance
have to be
of
maintained.
Them.
So, for instance, under shielding here, and which section is this? This is section 316E1 for shielding.
Yeah,
the top one.
Yeah.
All fixtures that are required to be filled fully shielded must be installed and maintained in such a way that the shielding is effective. And so you'll see that.
Yes.
So is that maintenance, the zoning administrators?
Yes.
Yeah.
So to speak?
Yeah,
so
and then
speak.
He or she would contact the property owner and ask them to do some maintenance on the light fixture.
Mm-hmm.
This is like...
Just like if a parking lot is flooded all the time.
Yeah, exactly. We do that too. Okay. I just want... It is apart from it being God's wish.
Or the lines don't get painted on a regular basis, so you don't know where to park anymore when you go shopping.
Yeah, we'll make a note of that as well.
Told you I'm going to take over Kathy's. That's in landscaping too, maintaining.
Yep.
You know, you put plantings in the beginning, and nine months later they're dead, you know.
Yep, there's language that we covers that as well. So there's also a section in here about lighting of signs and then lighting for specific uses that tend to have a lot of lighting. Rec fields, frontage, the front line of cars in a car dealership, and the lovely gas station canopy, which is always a glow.
Well, so would this apply to the town's rec fields, or is the town's? It does.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not going to apply to the streets.
No.
Nope.
But it will apply to the... So
the streets are right away, so zoning doesn't apply to the right away. But,
no.
But the town is a property owner.
So the properties the town owns, it would apply.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah,
so,
and
that,
this,
so that would be West River Park and Memorial Park.
Yeah.
So this does reference, because you obviously need higher intensity lighting than is otherwise allowed in this section for to play soccer at night or whatever. This does reference some standards for that.
I always know when they're playing baseball, football, because I can see the lights down
on my
street.
Yes, it sets up a timing for that.
You'll find it... both the installations at Memorial Park and West River Park meet the code, actually, for the sporting facilities installation.
That's good.
Yep.
So we come to outdoor storage or display. So this sets up standards as to what type of storage is allowed where on a lot, and whether there are buffers or setbacks or screening of some sort required, fencing, for different types of storage. So it has these five classes of storage. Do you think the table, it's clearer in the table form than it was in the text form? One of the zoning administrator's comments was that the previous form that this was in was a bit difficult to read and understand. So.
I think it is.
This is
good. I didn't have his...
I thought the table maybe made it a little more clear as to what fell where.
Yeah, I think it does.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it basically has these three columns here in Figure 3.16 of your personal storage, you know, storage of personal property on a residential property for the most part.
Yeah, it does.
And then
do.
Things that are for sale or lease, and then everything else that might be needed to be stored, and then sets classes for those.
Okay.
Is this where, what about something, I mean, again, this is probably not for personal property. How many cars you can have on a, do all cars, like, you could have one car registered and three cars sitting there with no plates? I mean, is that what this means when it says registered operated passenger
vehicle? So a registered operable passenger vehicle needs to have plates, be registered, and be able to be driven. So it is not the parts car that's up on blocks. So if you have the parts car that's up on blocks, that then falls into a different class of storage.
Storage.
Or planter, as some of us.
Yes, our planter.
Car planters,
The vehicle that's being used as a storage
growing.
Unit.
Yep.
That type of thing. Yeah. There was a big discussion of the junk car issues in my community. People came to this meeting and were screaming that all these junk cars were parts vehicles. And, and the town board bought this, and I pointed out later to the supervisor that in order for it to be a parts vehicle, I'm pretty sure it has to be the same type of vehicle as the one you were currently driving. And I only knew of one instance where somebody had a little Honda Civic, and they had two little other parts sitting in their yard. So I thought that there
too. That's pretty awesome.
They had two. I thought that those, well, I had one like that. It was one of the ancient little Civic hatchbacks, and I always thought if I needed something, I could go see this guy.
That's okay. I know a guy.
Yeah? Okay. Well, I don't have it anymore.
Oh, so good.
I have a neighbor who has lots of parked cars.
Yes, you do.
So they would all end up being, considered class four salvage materials?
Yes, essentially, if you're going to have...
Like random, unworking, unoperable, non-registered
cars. Yes, then you
cars.
Have become a salvage yard, yes.
Okay.
This is always an enforcement nightmare.
Right. And you can't have a salvage yard in a residential district, and thus the whole thing just...
God.
And there's actually state law now, too, that comes into effect. The state has really tightened up its...
Oh, really?
Its standards on the junk car and salvage yard stuff.
You know where there's...
But who enforces that?
Well, you have to get them upset about it at A&R.
If you sculpt your car into an art piece, is it no longer salvage material? And it is art on your property?
Like abandoned? And
I don't mean to give anyone ammunition, does
it? Yes.
That's interesting.
This is always a challenging one. In communities.
Yeah,
There's nothing around the fact that these...
We get relatively little given the potential for it, I guess is a nice way of saying it.
Yeah. Once again, it's usually a complaint-driven thing, so there's maybe places where neighbors don't mind that you have some cars.
Well, sometimes you just have to drive down that part of the street with your blinders on and look the other way, you know. I choose to look at the river instead. much more enlightening.
Yeah, really.
The riprap.
The riprap.
Section 318 deals with signs.
Oh, God, signs. Is this to replace our old sign ordinance?
Yes. This replaces the sign ordinance.
We are a fan of it.
We love this one.
Do you really?
Yeah.
It's
much better than...
It's
simpler.
It's better consistent. Organized. It's actually a little bit more generous. It's,
really?
It's a little bit more tied to it appropriately sizes to the size of the building. Or,
It just looks like it's more specific in different areas. I mean, I didn't really read through this section at all, but...
No, it's good.
Yeah.
It's good.
So, yeah, my philosophy on signs is that smaller is not always better, that the sign really should be proportional to the building that it's on. It looks much more... It's pleasing.
It needs to
is.
Be readable.
And it also needs to be readable given the distance it is from the road and the speed at which you're driving down. Otherwise, you might as well not have the sign in the first place.
Or it causes accidents.
Yes. So the idea behind this is to try to come to that balance and also to encourage a little more... I think the building-mounted signs, to encourage the building-mounted signs in the more walkable areas and discourage the freestanding signs a little bit there, and where you're more car-oriented, focus more on the freestanding. So they sort of invert in terms of where you get the most sign area that you can have. But it's meant to be pretty comprehensive and cover all of the components.
And you put them into zones, too. I thought that was... Mm-hmm.
Yes, so there are different zones.
So 318C. So 13 signs, flags, or banners mounted or extending more than 35 feet above the ground, or building mounted above the building roof line. We had that conversation about the flagpole.
Mm-hmm.
Is there, I'm just checking, there's no contradiction between those two?
We have, yes. We've dealt with the flagpole
somewhere else.
Elsewhere. I'm trying to remember exactly where we fit that in.
I remember that.
It's here somewhere, and I can't remember where it is off the top of my head.
Okay.
We dealt with the flagpole.
Mm-hmm. And then is there, the signs designed and located primarily to be visible from Interstate 91, would you be positive, would the DRB be positive, you could obviously know if it was deliberately to be, you know what I mean? I guess that's undisciplining.
Well,
here, so
that's actually a state regulation as well. But for instance, if you had a building that had its back...
91,
and it put a sign on the back of
that's
the building.
Obvious.
That's obviously that the sign is meant to be oriented to the interstate, or something that's, we don't allow it perhaps in these regulations, but, up on the roof.
Very high.
High is obviously meant to be...
Like
the T.
Like at the Albert Center, they have a big thing on top of the building.
Mm-hmm. Yes. Yeah.
Would that be grandfathered in?
It is.
It is grandfathered in already,
yeah. But in the future, that kind of thing is prohibited. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Besides, it makes it look like a billboard.
We had an interesting debate the other day about if you have a storefront and you etch the glass, or you have some kind of motif, repeating motif, that could, for instance, incorporate the logo of the store on the glass. Does that count as sign?
I would say if it incorporates the logo of the store, yes.
We decided not, though, Brian and I.
You were being very generous about window signs.
We're a nice town.
Because it's easier on enforcement.
Yeah.
It's just easier to say if it's no more than 25%, then it's fine.
Right.
You can have it there. Because there's a couple downtown businesses that that have it.
Is this?
It's just enforcement.
Mm-hmm. Right. I mean, it gets a little bit bizarre. So, you know, like the Chanel logo. I mean, there's some logos that are now like so patterned in people's consciousness that they don't necessarily pick them out as a logo.
Mm-hmm. More of a design.
I'm sure you're very conscious of the Chanel logo.
I look, you know, it's one of my major guy buying guys. Okay. You know, like you can tell, can't you?
I saw a bumper sticker the other night that I really wanted. It said, "Don't Jersey Vermont."
Mm-hmm. Oh, you haven't seen this before?
No.
This is the first time?
Yeah.
I'll get you one of
those. Oh, yeah, that's great.
Two questions. So the political campaign sign is not more than 4 square feet in area. It's like a 2x2. So this means, like, if you had one of those big ones that's like 6x4, then you need a zoning permit to put that out.
Yep.
On residential property. Okay.
Yeah.
And then signs for a special event, which is sponsored by a public or nonprofit organization. So my question there, because I work at a school that has an MBA in managing to sustain, like there are companies that might do special events that would not be geared specifically toward, you know what I mean? Like they may be a charity event at a company. Like, so would they not, would that not be include? That seems very specific to me. When you're talking about a special event
where
that you're
going to
be,
Kathy?
Removing. 318D4.
So it's the exemptions. And I think what we have to make sure that we're not doing is creating an exemption that... you have to be very careful about regulating the message of the sign. That's one prop.
The message?
The message of the sign. You
right,
run into
right,
First
yes.
Amendment. So we have to be very cautious about that. So this isn't really so much getting into the message as who is putting out the sign. And so if we took that public or nonprofit part out and just left sign for a special event that would be open to the general public, that would also cover your, you know, sale, your, you know, any store, the furniture sale. So, and this allows for that extra sign, so exempt. And you actually allow for temporary signs for that type of thing, but they require a zoning permit. So well, I see where you're headed with that, but I think
to remove it, then you're opening a whole bag of worms.
Yeah, you're really broadening that out. And
a can of worms.
Yeah. So we could try to reword it along the idea for a non-commercial public event, but it's getting a little dicier to go in that direction. And actually, the whole exemption, in honesty, for civic type signs is already a bit dicey.
Yeah, it's a pretty.
All right. Well, we don't have to complicate it. That's probably. Mm-hmm. I mean, those instances would be rare enough that.
And there is a mechanism for getting a permit for temporary signage.
Mm-hmm.
Yep.
Okay.
So.
Yep. I like the sign zones and the sign chart.
Very clear.
So we did put in some provisions for electronic message signs as well.
That was good.
Probably new language to have in terms of what would be allowed, where the electronic message signs will be allowed in the service center district. So I'll just go back here and look and see where we are. In zone two.
The one thing that I'm read this a couple of times now, and I don't know if it necessarily. Well, 7D, changeable copy electronic message signs must not flash, scroll, fade, brighten, dim, or otherwise be animated or create the effect of movement. So that is enough that's adequate to cover those LED signs that do some kind of change.
Yeah, we could,
you know,
put
like
a time limit in there that they can only be changed, and maybe we should.
We do.
Well, actually,
E.
We do. It goes down below there. That's
right.
I think D is actually. I think D is in our existing.
They're giving
yes.
that.
Yes.
That it does do every. Yeah.
But
do you mean
the,
like
do you
things
know
that
one,
say
right.
soda $1.99, then tissues that kind of thing? Is that what you're talking about?
Well, there's new ones. For instance, the really irritating ones that do things like, you know, if it's for a car wash or something, it'll show the car going through the car wash. It has
that's
this,
the idea.
It's
yep.
an animation process.
Yeah.
But
yep. oh.
I'm wondering whether that captures all the possible scenarios for somehow animating the sign, you know what I'm getting at?
Mm-hmm.
With the LED
yeah, I mean,
signs.
It's basically a TV screen at this point.
Yes, yes.
Well,
exactly.
But we also do say in C, multicolor changeable copy electronic signs are prohibited. So a lot of those LED ones are, I mean, there was one up on Putney Road that was used to.
I guess what I'm trying to get is this TV concept, so that the copy itself may not change, but
the image behind it does.
The image behind it does.
Mm-hmm. Well, I can ponder that and come back.
Yeah, I think it's okay, but I'm just...
I want to make sure we're covering
the description of the way those new signs work.
And this is the kind of thing
work.
That is changing all the time, you know?
Yeah,
yep.
So just say no, I think.
So we do make two special exemptions for those signs so that you can have the electronic message signs to a greater extent for a theater marquee. And also at gas stations for the pricing signs.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So we have made two provisions for that.
Yeah. I have a question back on the under electronic messaging signs.
Mm-hmm.
F. The brightness of a sign must not be of such an intensity. Is that too general a statement?
Well, it does then have
a
standard for foot candles after it, and those signs can be set up to adjust as the ambient light conditions change.
Oh, okay.
And that needs to be turned on, essentially.
So there's enough clarification
yep.
there?
Yep.
Yep.
That's
so
not
there's
really
a menu
that general.
That controls the
mm-hmm.
sign, and you select that it does respond to ambient light conditions.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, okay, because the sentence by itself is
right.
mm-hmm.
very vague.
Yep.
When these go into effect, are the existing like signs in businesses and stuff grandfathered, or do they then need to? I mean,
mm-hmm.
it's a sign; you take it out of the window relatively easily. So they need to redecorate according to this zoning.
No.
They
no,
get
it's
to keep
as long
it.
As their permit is in effect.
Yeah.
So we have a section 318K for non-conforming signs, and that is the language that will govern at what point. You know, and you have to bring your non-conforming sign into compliance.
Oh.
So you can basically repair it and keep it in operation, but at the point at which you're really going to change its message, its essential content, then it has to be brought into conformance, or if it has been damaged to a significant extent, then it would have to be brought into conformance
mm-hmm.
as well. And if the use is discontinued, the sign goes away with the use. And
this is
going to must not return.
Very busy, isn't it?
Signs always keep them busy.
Yeah, signs are
wow.
a main thing. So the only thing that I noticed on a second read through this that I did not include, that I sometimes do include in sign sections, is a section that describes how to calculate the sign area. And provides a little bit of a bonus because for creatively shaped signs, because sign area is usually defined as a rectangle, you know, around the sign. And so if you have a sign that is not a rectangle, you often are losing out, but you might want to encourage more creative signs other than
mm-hmm.
rectangles. So I sometimes include a section that gives, you know, you calculate how much open space there is in your sign. And if it's a large percentage of open space, you get to increase the sign area. A bit. So that is one provision I noticed I had missed in my sign standard
mm-hmm.
section. Where
that's
I
nice.
Sometimes use. And I think that
yeah.
that's, you know, it helps for those creative things.
Yeah.
There's a violin mm-hmm. maker sign in Dummerston that's really cute and clever. It has a cutout of a violin in it.
Mm-hmm.
There used to be one on Flat Street or Elliott Street, too. Either
yeah.
for Monica, I think.
And I didn't include the language that I sometimes, I think, do in here about the three-dimensional sign, which basically is language that says, good luck figuring out what size it is.
I think we would like both those things.
Yeah.
Yes.
How to measure
yeah.
the sign
so,
area.
Yeah,
yes.
I think that actually that language that I normally use for the sign area calculation includes something about the three-dimensional signs, but really, you know, it's a good luck sort of situation on those.
So this was 8 pages on signs. Is that considerably less than what it was? Must be, huh?
I don't know if it's less than pages, but it's much better organized. Yeah. And
so do you think we should stop here and talk about the public outreach component? We're at 7:30.
Yeah, I think that would be good.
Or we could do nuisance.
I was thinking we should do nuisance because
okay.
It's pretty quick.
Quick nuisance is pretty
and then we
short.
Can save the resource
stuff.
Resource protection for
okay.
The next morning.
Okay.
I'm
going
to
have
kind of meaty.
We're going to have to get writing because we made it through this.
I know.
We have 2 more chapters that go in this section that aren't written yet. So
wow.
Get those churned up.
Nuisance is what page?
333. Chapter 320. So these are basic performance standards for the most part. They cover all the ways in which one.
But if we don't have a sound meter or noise meter.
Well, you rent one.
Yeah. That's not a big deal.
Yeah, the other thing about.
My company used to rent one all the time because way it's calibrated and
yeah.
You don't have to worry about it.
Right. The other thing to be said about this that's kind of important is it's in your ability to do it properly is enhanced by training, but it's actually something that's usually fairly easy to challenge. It's actually, sound is not as easy to deal with as you might think.
Yeah, like
tricky business.
Yeah, oh, it is totally like ours that workmen who make noise, like utility workers or
mm-hmm.
road crews or construction on a site, you know, in a residential neighborhood. How early can they start? You know, when they're pounding and hammering or jackhammering or digging or
so something like that. Would not be subject to these.
Right.
Yeah.
But that's something that the Development Review Board can place conditions on.
We do.
When it does.
Yep.
Yeah, they're like town ordinances around
this. There's town ordinances.
Yeah. Yeah, we have.
Yeah, but this is like.
That's like a health standard.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Or how about if somebody goes and decides to mow their lawn at 5:30 in the morning?
Again, that's not land use.
And the police,
and
the police, the
town
ordinance and the police enforce that.
Okay, that's a whole different category.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Yeah, we're talking about, you know, something that's consistent with the use. So if you've got a bowling alley in a residential neighborhood and you hear the pins being knocked over and then reset,
which I find highly unlikely.
Well, around here because people will never hit them probably, but
could be outdoor seating for a restaurant. It could be
the
drive-through.
Yeah, like the same place
yard.
That had the Don't Jersey Vermont. It was a bar and it closes at 10:30. Or you have to stop playing music at 10:30 because it's in a residential neighborhood.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. The event venue that has loud parties and weddings go on to all hours.
Yeah, in a residential neighborhood.
Yeah, or somebody that sets up a small machine shop, you know, a repair shop or something in a garage, and then, you know, at some point it becomes an issue, that kind of stuff.
Yeah, yeah. Okay.
It's something consistent with the use.
Mm-hmm.
Where was this bar?
Saxon's River.
Oh.
So, yeah. So, in addition to noise, this covers glare, odors, which are even more difficult to regulate than noise.
Yeah, there's a machine for that.
Vibration, electrical radio interference, waste storage. Articulate matter and airborne
cells. You can go to the FCC on electrical radio interference.
Yeah.
It's funny. I've
interfering with people's
kind of performance standard thing. So I've always been a little.
There's
no need to like them because I think they provide a level of assurance.
Yeah, they're a backstop against the terrible.
Yeah.
Right, but they're not really meaning. Yeah. Well.
Yeah.
They give you somewhere to go if something really runs.
I'm sure
off
in others, in other communities, in other parts of the country,
you can measure electrical radio interference. That's actually pretty easy to measure.
You can measure vibration and particulate matter as well, but it's a level of measurement that most, you know,
you used to call me
wanna.
Up on the phone and you could hear the Red Sox baseball game in the evenings.
Mm-hmm.
I lived next door to the radio station.
Oh, okay.
Can the wording of 329B is a little confusing to me because it almost seems like you're suggesting that they must be released into the environment. Should it say toxic or hazardous substances or waste must not be released into the environment?
We can do it that way. So put in the no at the beginning.
No toxic must be released into the environment.
So. We'll just take the no out of the beginning of the sentence and put not after must.
Great.
Okay.
Okay.
You made it. Thank you. That's great.
All right.
Well, we're getting back on sketch.
Okay.
Woohoo.
That was really good. Thank you.
So, given that we have the zoning district run through and we have the map, we're basically at a point to start doing the public outreach. I think if we continue on in this vein, by the end of the calendar year, we're going to have actually a complete draft, essentially.
Yeah, good.
And January is probably at this time of the year. We wouldn't do much between now and January for public outreach. So I think we should come up with a strategy to start doing a more intensive public outreach effort in January. And
when you say that, what are you thinking of?
Well, we talked at the very beginning of this process about doing some neighborhood meetings, and I'm still somewhat leaning in that direction in terms of going out and introducing the zoning districts and the standards basis where we're in the area where people are going to be interested in. So trying to do all of them in one great big meeting, which
would
be a bit overwhelming.
You want to break it down into rural and non-rural?
And perhaps even a little more than two.
How many districts are there at this point?
Well,
not including the special and
six
the
overlay. Maybe?
Yeah.
So it'd be like six potentially six house parties in different facilities in that new district,
And we might not necessarily need a one for each district. For instance, we could probably do, I was thinking a little more maybe geographic differences in parts of the town, because obviously the urban center and mixed use districts are kind of one thing, and
West Brattleboro Association.
West Brattleboro would be one to look at, which might cover both West Brattleboro and the rural business one as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And maybe do one that's focused on the Putney Road northern piece. I don't know.
And then like a rural one.
We'd probably capture much of the rural feedback with West Brattleboro.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So I think, but we might, that might raise the possibility of two sessions with basically the same group, the West Brattleboro Association, because there may be enough material to justify two events with them.
Mm-hmm.
One having a focus on the village center and the rural commercial district, and the other one on the rural. But it's basically, and I think that they would view that positively. I think.
And how would this be done in a way that's fun and engaging?
She says that.
Because the first thing I thought of was like game show or and I said house party on purpose.
Yes, I noticed that.
And when you guys did, what was it, like several years ago, you did the display things where people came in and they put their dots up and stuff, something where it's kind of like
interactive
and fun, and there's food and
dots,
music,
dots.
Or
we should get more dots. Actually, I think we've still got
a lot of dots.
We got several dots.
Yeah, we
dots.
Do. We have a lot of dots.
So we can dotify the whole thing again. So,
do you have ideas about that, Brandy, or at least you can?
I think we can do that. I wanted to get a sense from you guys in terms of breaking it out into areas, and then I can work up some potential approaches to that for our next meeting to sort of have some agendas to look at.
Emphasis on fun.
Emphasis on fun.
Yeah.
And
you
images,
guys think about you
like,
guys think
yeah.
about
maps
venues,
and
maybe
pictures.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I remember one
the,
meeting that had to do with franchises, though. That but where did we hold that? Some small little room, but there was different.
scenarios all around the room with, and you know, and again, that was a dot kind of thing, but mm-hmm. you know, there was definitely pictures and mm-hmm. descriptions, and people could kind of, you know, say what they liked or what they didn't like. And
well, I kind of get the sense too, though, that in explaining especially what we just went through, the design standards and yeah. everything, you have to have a sense of what was
yes.
in
yes.
order to understand that this is better. Because if someone's confronted with this detail, they'll say, why do we even need that?
That's
so
right.
It needs to be, you know, you need to really explain its purpose mm-hmm. and value mm-hmm. and what was and why this is better for it to be effective.
Yeah, I was thinking in terms of the, you know, the presentation elements or the visual elements for the meeting, that the new purpose statement needs to be, you know, made clear and mm-hmm. made a big feature of, and
each time
mm-hmm. again compare that to the old one, there's probably not that much difference in some ways between a lot of those. But then I think that the before and after, kind of, for want of a better term, before and after is an important thing to develop. It, you know, reduce it maybe to two columns.
Mm-hmm.
Or the other way of approaching it is, what problems are we setting out to address with the changes that we're making?
Yeah. And what planning principles are we?
Yeah, and what planning principles are we implementing with the changes?
Mm-hmm. I think we have to be careful on...
What?
Well, I just think that can get pretty techie. I think what problems we're setting out to address is important. The planning principles, I'm not sure for the public meeting, definitely for adoption and stuff.
I think for certain audiences that one would be useful, mm-hmm. maybe, so that the DAB we should think of as having a special one
and
or two meetings with them
board.
And the select board.
We could do that one
those
even together.
Entirely different kind of
constituencies. And the broader public, I think, focusing on the problems that we're setting out to solve. Sometimes we're setting out to solve somebody else's problem,
mm-hmm.
and we need to be clear about that too. So where the state or federal requirements have changed or something else is coming down on us, we should just be really clear that that's what we're responding to, because that's part of what we're trying to do. I don't feel like there's any external requirement that's being forced upon us that we're uncomfortable with. It's just a reality.
Yeah.
And it's okay. For the most part, they're okay.
Right.
Mm-hmm. There should also probably be some explicit imaging or referencing to the town plan and the West Brattleboro plan and how and the connection between what has mm-hmm. the choices that were made that reflect those plans.
I think that gets sort of to Liz's point that a lot of the town plan contains, you know, policy statements that have guided this project.
Mm-hmm.
So the planning principles in some ways are in fact the principles and goal statements that you find in the town plan itself. So connecting it back to the town plan, I think, is important to do. But
and I'm sure that's what the select board's going to be looking for.
Yeah.
Yeah.
At their meeting, yeah.
So you wanted to get a sense of
who our target audiences are, so I can work up good approaches to those target audiences.
So I think, well, the West Brattleboro Association is kind of a business group, but they're pretty... they have a
pretty broad,
pretty big stakeholder list. You could easily get, you know, residents,
a group.
You know.
Yeah, mm-hmm. we can feed. So they maintain a really extensive contact list,
mm-hmm.
and so.
And also with advertisements in the paper and announcements mm-hmm. and whatnot, that'll.
Right. Yeah, I think the Downtown
Alliance, which is the replacement for what mm-hmm. was, it's a new name for an organization that was called Building a Better Brattleboro.
Mm-hmm.
And then I think there is a North End.
Do they still exist?
I don't know. I saw Gary today. I should have asked him. There was an association of predominantly commercial
mm-hmm.
businesses in the Putney Road
mm-hmm.
neighborhood.
I don't know if Feet exists, but I think that could be interesting based on the changes that we're seeing in the Elm and that we're proposing.
That's right.
It's Frost Elliott Elm Triangle.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I don't know if they're still going or not. Do you know?
I don't know.
Okay.
I don't think they've been.
Right.
And maybe, or even if the Clark
Canal.
Clark Canal.
Even if they don't, there's vestiges of it around.
Okay. There's something that we could probably tie that whole
that could area be all of Clark
Street
in
one meeting.
Yeah. Right. Because
that's like neighborhoods. Those are areas we talked a lot about.
Right.
Also. Mm-hmm.
Maybe we can, for that meeting or something, try and meet at New England Youth Theater or something like that.
Yeah.
That's in the neighborhood.
Mm-hmm. Are there... So these would be special meetings?
Mm-hmm.
And are we going to have any more additional meetings in November and December?
We briefly talked about that. Given the progress that we made tonight, I don't know that we definitely need to, but if you are interested in doing one, I'm available November 19th, which is a Wednesday evening. That's a good evening for me. If you do want to schedule another one, I would start with that and see if we can achieve a quorum for that. And
I'd rather not have another one in December.
That's what I was thinking as well, that if you wanted to have one more meeting, then we should do it in November.
We just made a segue and I wasn't quite sure we were done.
Yeah.
Sorry. No, that's okay. I'm just trying to catch us on, we can make a choice to talk about the calendaring thing, but I don't want to miss the opportunity to continue to brainstorm other...
Mm-hmm. And you don't want to come back on November the 18th to do the brainstorming?
I don't
want to.
Yeah. For
okay. That's fine.
A night away from the children, so I don't.
Just edit that out.
Well, at this rate, I mean, if we didn't meet again, we'd only have one more meeting before January.
One more meeting in December.
Did you say Wednesday? Did you say the 18th was a Tuesday?
I said the 19th.
Wednesday.
Yeah. Right?
Yes.
And it's the week before Thanksgiving. It's not Thanksgiving week.
Right.
That's whoa. What is all that going on there?
And then the week after is...
Yeah, the week after.
Forget about it.
And our regular December meeting is...
The first?
Or...
Really?
Yeah, it's the first.
Yeah. It should be 2 weeks later. So it'd be 2 weeks, 2 weeks, and 2 weeks.
So the 19th, I mean, we could just say the 19th and let's say go and see who shows up because we're having a...
Why don't I try to get a quorum? Yeah, I mean, it doesn't seem to make sense to... I don't know.
Book a meeting when we don't know. Right.
Yeah. Why don't I see...
You,
I mean, I think David is not available for extra meetings. So let's see what we can get a quorum.
And is James actually gone now?
No,
not yet.
No, he's just busy. Okay, so to go back to Kathy's point then, other meeting-y type things to do?
So I was almost wondering if, I'm just thinking like how do you, maybe you don't really need to, but, you know, it's always nice to just try to like cross the boundary into the line of people that don't normally come or something. So, I was thinking of like picking venues in neighborhoods according to like fun value or something else.
Okay, so there's the Cherry
Street. Wind and Wines or...
Yes.
You obviously need some space.
Mm-hmm.
So
it's the Cherry Street Artisans Co-op group.
Mm-hmm. Where's the...
It's...
By the hospital.
Yeah.
That sort of neighborhood,
It's near the hospital, and it sort of, as a neighborhood, it loosely clusters around the gazebo there.
Oh, yeah, okay.
Okay, and so I think that the people, those people who are members of that group are, loosely connected to to that area, so that would be an interesting group maybe to reach out to. I often thought at the scale of the problem with Brattleboro, to some extent, is that the elementary schools are school choice in the sense that you can send your kid to any one of the three schools or whatever it is, right? So you don't have the tight fit between neighborhood and elementary school that you might expect.
Mm-hmm.
That being said, we could try and approach, hold things in hold things in schools or approach the, parent-teacher associations for each of the schools, assuming that there's some level of interest about the quality of life questions that the zoning ordinance is attempting to address.
Hmm.
But that's just, I mean, that's a, it's kind of a stretch, and I don't know if it would work. Mm-hmm. But, you know, it's one possibility. We could hold the West Brattleboro thingy in the Academy School.
Yeah.
That's a, yeah, that's a nice space.
People have used that before for meetings, all kinds of meetings.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But,
the space at the meeting house, that was nice too. I don't think it's cheap though. It's
All right. I just the school thing just, you know,
school thing is
I don't know if it'd work or not, but it's just I'm trying to think of other reasons people meet that would have some kind of overlap with the the broad goals that we're trying to achieve.
Well, town meeting meets there
at Academy School.
Yeah.
It's interesting though, because it's like, I think I was barking up a whole different tree. To me, that's the same sort of, like, you know.
Oh, you want more of a party atmosphere.
Yeah. I'm like, pick the Ford dealership or pick, you know, pick something completely random, you know.
Where, yeah, I agree.
You may be brokering some kind of partnership that you don't already have, because it's...
No, I think in some level that a venue such as that would be good. Just because it's so off the ordinary.
Great idea.
Is the signage of the car dealership?
Landscaping.
People run out the flagpole.
Let me see, which car dealership would that be appropriate at?
Well, it's hard to, you know, I'm like, would the outlet centers be a place where, you know, it's, I have a hard time pulling up this type of information in my head, but I feel like in the hospital
has a nice meeting room.
The hospital has a nice room, and it's another constituency in a way that, yeah.
I think NEYT could be interesting too.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Unless, but also the Elliott Street Cafe. I don't know.
So it's
shut. Open, but
it's closed.
I don't think they're open anymore.
No, it's too bad.
And then there's the lobby of the Brooks House.
Oh, the Brooks House.
Yep.
Because then we can all get yogurt.
Yeah, that'd be nice. And then industrial, like, you know, do you go to, I'm pulling this out of my hat because I can't remember what's where. It's like, go to Omega or Cromer or something, or Familari Place, or... The
Familari is kind of
next
semi-
to Route 91.
They won't give us play.
Right.
Remember, we tried to get space there.
Yeah, right.
I wonder if there's anything in the ST complex.
There could be fun.
Buildings.
I'm sure there is there. Yeah.
Where's that?
ST. The ST complex.
Oh, yeah.
I was wondering, I don't mean to divert from a potential locations, but... You know, we named a couple of groups, and I wonder if we would want to do some more to address the standards. We haven't talked about the environmental resource protection standards, but it's a lot more advanced than anything we have in the existing ordinance.
Yes.
So I even wonder if some sort of breakfast or a lunchtime brown bag session, even if it's at the River Garden. I don't know, just something to try to get that those people who work in that field or who feel strongly about it, maybe as a group that we can get on our side.
Mm-hmm.
Citizens breakfast.
You know, if the Scion group might be good to discuss the building standards, because
that's the thing.
They really talk about building standards all the time. And they'd be interested.
Yeah.
I mean, they would want more sustainable building practices in general. So. Mm.
So, yeah, I think if we can sort of run this through a little bit, think about these, and I think thinking about not only alternate venues, but some alternate times is good too, so that we have a mixture of different
breakfast,
approaches.
Lunch.
Yeah.
Evening.
If we can, the other thing to think about is if we can sort of schedule out something that's a sort of a public outreach program over a fairly compact schedule, but trying a bunch of different things could be good as well. So we may be able to raise the profile of the activities because of, we have a bunch of different things and different opportunities for people to
come at any of these times. Make advertisement of the whole thing as a whole. Yeah.
Yeah, it'd be fun to figure out how to integrate like kids. I don't know why I'm thinking
five different choices
like
of meetings you can
come
to one
at
all.
You know what I mean? Where there, like, there would be like
I think that would
a game show or I don't know. You know,
well,
is there a way to?
I definitely want to do.
How do you
some information, some BCTV programming. So even if it's just me yapping at the screen, without my sidekick from previous efforts.
I think we can bring him back.
Yeah.
Special.
You know, I think that
should
that would be
here
fun.
Anyway.
That's right.
Visual, even if it's like a 15-minute
special,
thing.
Special
yeah,
guest.
Just something
special
that's kind of visual
star.
And
yeah, special guest stuff. I think that's what we're going to do. So, but I think that. One possibility is to even conduct sort of something like an open house format. In, I guess what I'm liking from your suggestion is sort of to be somewhere completely unexpected and to present it. So
mm-hmm.
our friend Dana from Essex, is
Essex,
it?
Essex, yeah.
Went to a farmer's market
mm-hmm.
as part of their outreach process with a town plan and had a graphically rich thing that
oh, yeah.
they set up at a farmer's market and got responses right. from. There are ways in which the use of Google Earth has been really a breakthrough for us,
mm-hmm.
probably not so much for other people. But that,
mm-hmm.
you know, that's a very engaging and effective communication tool to
mm-hmm.
discuss the boundary topic alone, right?
Mm-hmm.
So
you might want to have like several farmers markets, like
yes.
every Saturday for a month.
Right.
Oh, it's the winter. Yeah, maybe.
Yeah, the winter
yeah,
farmers
the winter
market in the whatever it's called.
River
Garden. So okay. just things, but and then try and think of compacting down some of the presentation. You know, we've worked through it fairly conscientiously and, you know, to resolve questions for ourselves, but there's a way in which we could go back using the same technology and do sort of a guided tour, for instance, of
mm-hmm.
things
oh,
like the district boundary changes or something like that. We could make it a feature of those geographically specific outreach sessions like West Brattleboro or whatever,
mm-hmm.
but we could also make another one that was a little bit more general. That could, you can know, you could run it on TV, you know,
mm-hmm.
there's all sorts of interesting things that you could do with that.
We talked in the beginning about I think David had the idea. Is there a place where people could drop things on a map? So if they're looking at I'm trying to just think how it would work for zoning districts, but
mm-hmm.
You know, perhaps they can be fooling around with the Google Earth,
mm-hmm.
which is a little bit difficult because they have to download it. But whatever, they could drop a node in that we could later see, and they could say, well, you're
what's
crazy,
that?
You
yeah,
know.
Yeah,
what,
what's this or why?
I don't agree. I think it should be
mm-hmm.
this or something.
Right.
Or do you think
I
that
think
doesn't work so well?
There are technologies out there to do that. I haven't played with any of the ones for maps that much.
Mm-hmm.
But I also let me look and see what my SurveyMonkey thing lets me do too. Because it may
mm-hmm.
be possible
yeah,
to
okay.
post some. It might not be the Google Earth interactive one, but we may be able to do some. We can definitely do images and take comments on those through
mm-hmm.
that mechanism. So let me see what I can do from a technology standpoint. The map can be put on a web page pretty easily and let people zoom in and out of it.
Mm-hmm.
In terms of commenting on it, it's possible. Let's see what's out there that,
yeah.
that does that easily.
it might be interesting. Well, this is I can always offer up Marlboro grad center, but that gets used a lot for stuff like this, so I don't think it's
yeah.
like the best location, except that I was just thinking we do have a big screen and a computer, and it
mm-hmm.
almost might be fun to have like an exhibit situation
mm-hmm.
where you just
have
it open and
yeah.
you invite people to play with the map
yes.
so that the whole room can actually see, you know, any random manipulation
right.
of it, which
mm-hmm.
might
some,
cause
other people processing
like
the same people processing
right.
their thing, which would then generate questions for
yeah.
you. The other possibility I thought about is that it's pretty dowdy, and I'm sure the fire marshal would have concerns or something, but we've got a very wide hallway here, and we don't use it very much. I think we're limited in the way we can use it because it's a public building, and you're supposed to not interfere with people's ability to stampede
ingress.
Out of here or something.
Yeah.
But we have the walls available to us, I guess.
Yeah.
That's another thing I was thinking is maybe you could find a partner for a gallery walk in January or February and actually make an exhibit.
Yes, that's what I was thinking too.
Yeah.
This would be a bit of a stretch as a destination for a gallery walk, I guess.
Well, there's the whole building on Flat Street that was the, what's her name from, who's in Walpole now, she had a temporary gallery there. The furniture store.
Yeah, Sennell. Mm-hmm.
Sennell building. Mm-hmm. And that's a big wide open space that's mm-hmm. been used in different ways. I mean,
for different things.
For different things, and so people are used to going there mm-hmm. during gallery walk.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And then the other thing I was thinking is there any way to integrate this into the Winter Carnival?
You are thinking fun.
Yes.
Yeah, I think we should print the new district boundary map on beer coasters.
Yeah, there you go. I'm going way back in the beginning of the town plan.
The Whetstone Station. What can they do? Yeah,
we had a meeting that was at the Marlborough Grad Center where we invited 100 people to come for their feedback.
Yep.
And then from that was the town, that was the scoping group, and then there was the town plan advisory group, and maybe we just have a big meeting and invite people.
Yep.
And then we could do that because they've been interested in, you know, make the invitation be like you've been chosen because, you know, you've been part of these things in the past. Yeah, you're special. And that could be at Marlborough Grad Center doing some outrageous kind of
experimental
thing. I mean, I think there is something to that about sending a personal invitation. You know,
And all those people have participated already.
But trying to get people from
the
brain.
Like,
and that's what
it's a card that says, new zoning, you care?
Don't ask that question.
You'll
dig up all the non-zoning sites.
Yeah, right.
Yeah.
Can't ask
you
the question.
You will care.
And then maybe the museum.
Yes, I think the museum would be a potential for a site during gallery walk or something.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Wait till if they have some exhibit on architecture.
Well, the community room of the co-op is not a bad one.
Yeah, or I was thinking even just in the I don't know if they would do it, but the foyer of Wyndham Regional Commission, that big space where Wyndham Regional Commission is. I mean, it's horribly lit. But
Cotton Mill Hill?
No.
Right. Oh, Wyndham Regional. Oh, yes.
Outside the gallery space.
Outside the gallery.
That's actually not a bad space.
There's
a
nice...
It's a good space.
For the window... I guess that's where they stockpiled all the windows.
Oh, are they?
But they must have gone into the Brooks House by now, isn't that?
They're not there now. It's empty.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
There's probably also rooms at like the hotels that are on
the
road.
Yeah, there are. Actually, we did something at the Hampton in one time, and they were actually...
We got a reasonable response to that.
Really?
Yeah, and they were...
Mm-hmm. They were fine. They were good, actually. They were
supportive.
That would be a good...
Potluck?
That would be a good one for like the North End Business Association for doing something.
Only if the food that you bring is representative of some aspect of the zoning ordinance.
I like that.
So,
there's a challenge.
So
right
I think
there.
Huge amounts of sheet cake is called for. And then the frosting
but
needs to
be
the zoning
district.
It has to
be the correct dimension.
That's right.
We could have that as an offer.
Right. Should we do it? Should we really do it?
Waterfront overlay pie.
Now that's stew.
That's like the pies and charts thing you went to. I mean, those are really...
Yeah, we're still covering.
They went to a pies and chart thing and
you're
they served all sorts of pies and they showed all sorts of charts about...
This would be a funny... Actually, this is kind of... Yeah, you could maybe partner with like the co-op and the farmer's market to do some like food challenges around interpreting zoning.
Well, you can make a map with food.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Okay. Well, you have given me a lot of
food.
It is after 8 o'clock.
Yeah, all right.
Okay. Yes,
so actually, no, this is, I think we have some ideas here that I think we can sort of do. I want to do a mix of things. So we do a couple of, you know, these more conventional, we go out and meet with a group that you know you have. I think having some sort of exhibit component is good. I love this guided tour idea that we could do, because that could run on the TV, we could do that via the internet, we could set it up in some location where it could loop.
Be in a loop.
Yes.
I think that's doable as well. So there's ideas aplenty here, we just need to kind of...
Pick some.
Pick the right theme to go with each type of activity.
What's the overall schedule? We're going to do this in January, February, and then...
That was the idea, roughly, is to do the public outreach in... Certainly not beginning before the latter half of January, the second half of January.
When the kids are back.
Mm-hmm.
And each one is going to have a snow day.
Right. Nah.
We're a tough town. People come out.
Well, that's the one thing that would be beneficial about sort of doing
a
collective group.
I still think that's a good idea.
If we do have a blizzard, you know, it doesn't take out our one thing that we've got scheduled.
There we go.
Yeah, we have three different meetings.
Mm-hmm.
I think
four.
From other things, there's a sort of a momentum that you can get up on. It would be very challenging, but it could be worth figuring out whether we can schedule something, you know, at least once every 2 weeks.
Mm-hmm.
Or something for an extended period of time, so that there is a level of buzz around because we're at various places so frequently over a period of time that people begin to see the links, if you like.
And that was a good idea to have them all advertised as a set.
Yeah,
right.
Yeah, mm-hmm. She started saying that, and I picked up on it.
Yeah,
yeah.
Yeah, like to put together a schedule first. Okay.
When they did
schedule
the
first, and then
the Michael, whatever his name is, thing when they were doing the museum, they had one meeting at night, and then one the next day, or then a third one that was a compilation, and it was kind of like a package deal too. You could go to
concentrated.
Yeah,
right.
Concentrated.
Mm-hmm.
Yep. That draws people.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And from my scheduling point of view, I'd rather cluster a few together, come and manage them,
especially
and then,
in January.
Yeah.
Yeah. Okay.
And then have a little time and do another.
Have
set.
A blizzard of meetings.
And why do people get...
That's a good...
it actually
could be a good...
Actually, though, on the
it's
weather
a good indoor activity.
They're saying it's might tend to be an El Nino year, and we tend to have more snow than normal in the El Nino years, whereas the upper Midwest, is it? The Dakotas and all that place up there has less.
Yep.
That's what they were saying on the Weather Channel today.
But it won't be as cold.
No, because there'll be more snow. Thank God.
All right. So are we
I make a motion
adjourn?
We adjourn.
Second.
On the
it is done.